mechanism to strengthen the health system. And the objective is to review the recent developments in the scholarships on PPP for health, particularly with reference to the initiatives under the National Health Mission, and to propose a conceptual framework for measuring the effectiveness of PPPs in terms of their ability to meet the health system goals. The earlier research which I had done was based on governance of PPPs, in which I had used a network organization's perspective to explain the public-private partnership, and I applied the inter-organizational relations framework to study the resource and information flow in the PPPs and the mechanisms of coordination. So I had done this study in Rajasthan in a particular district. So if you look at the structure of the network, I mean, I have conceptualized that the public-private partnerships in a particular district, they emerge in the form of a network, and which is held together by the flow of information and resources. So the chief medical and health officer of the particular district is the focal organization, and then the linkages of the CMNHO with the different providers, service providers and all, the linkages are mapped, and the resource and information flows were studied. So here these triangles represent the state level agencies, like the Directorate of Medical and Health Services and the Secretariat at the state level. And then at the district level, apart from the CMHO, there is the district collector, Zilla Parishad, district education officer and principal medical officer, who are working together. Then there are, I had also conceptualize the formation of agencies, which is called agencification. So at state level, there is the Rajasthan State AIDS Control Society, which is a separate agency from the government. Mm-hmm. And at the district level, there are agencies like District Blindness Control Society, District RCH Society, Rajasthan Medicare Relief Society. So these, the partnerships are made operational through these agencies at the district level. And then this is the entire network of NGOs, private and private for-profit providers, which is operationalized through these agencies in the form of contracts. So the yellow ellipses, they represent the NGOs and the private for-profit providers who are also on the governing board of these agencies. Mm-hmm. So they also get an opportunity to influence the policy making processes. Whereas the other ones, the white ones, are the service delivery NGOs, philanthropists, voluntary organizations, private providers, social workers, and so on. Then is the resource and information flow in the network. These are the actors in the network. So the resource flow is unidirectional, that is from the government or the agency to the voluntary organization or the private for-profit provider. And the resource flow can be one-time, such as the allocation of land or grant, and it can be recurrent also, like when the items are given in kind, like sutures and lenses for performing cataract surgeries, contraceptives, IEC material, and so on. Then the information flow is two-way. The information in the form of contracts, guidelines, rules for carrying out the service delivery, this flows from government and agency to the voluntary organizations and private providers. And the information flow can also be one time or it can be recurrent. And the information from the government or agency also serves as an ex ante control mechanism. And the information which flows from the voluntary organizations and private providers to the government and agencies is in the form of utilization certificates, fund allocation, utilization of funds, and the performance reports and all. And this can be recurring. So, and after the resource and information flow, we had actually studied the mechanisms of coordination among the government and agencies and the service providers. And we could identify 29 mechanisms of coordination. But most of these were formal mechanisms, like having meetings, field visits, committees, and so on. And so the coordination was more hierarchical and formalized and less based on norms, reputation, and trust. And so we have concluded in that research that for effective network governance, there is a need to reduce the power asymmetry. There is need to rely more on informal mechanisms of sustaining the partnership, and to develop horizontal coordination, trust and social capital. And so what we had proposed is that in the partnership to be really effective, the government should give up some of its centralized control and make space for greater participation of the NGOs and private providers. And when we say that governance is the shift from government from doing to facilitating or from doing to steering, but that kind of thing has not happened. Even like after so many years, when I look at the literature again, the same issues are again there, that the power asymmetry is there, lack of trust is there. So nothing has changed. Maybe it is too early also to say that things would change. And then I have also looked at the recent literature on PPPs for health, and there is one systematic review in which they had studied 46 articles, and out of those, 7 were from health policy and 4 were from health policy and planning. And the research themes which they found that had been covered in these articles were mostly effectiveness of the PPP, benefits of the PPP, and then the country overviews. And then if you look at the recent policy initiatives for PPP in the Indian context, I mean, I feel that the approach of the government is mostly formalistic and legalist. It is just proposing more regulation, more law, more guidelines, more contracts and all. Like the Kelkar committee, which was formulated by the Ministry of Finance, they have proposed that there is need for PPP law or regulation to enable the foray of PPPs in the health sector. And then the Department of Economic Affairs has come up with a set of green books, which contain the model concession agreements for PPPs, like PPPs for diagnostic services, PPPs for greenfield hospitals, PPPs for brownfield hospitals, and so on. And then this one more shift has been there, that greater involvement of the private corporate sector, I mean for-profit corporate sector in the PPPs, and that has been enabled, one, by the India Brand Equity Foundation, which is under the Ministry of Commerce, and the second is the amendment in the Companies Act, which has brought in the mandate for corporate social responsibility. And KPMG had recently done a survey of N100, the top 100 listed companies in terms of market capitalization, and they found that 21.77 billion rupees has been spent on health out of the total expenditure on CSR by these companies, and that 95% of the companies are spending on health. So health is given the topmost priority by the companies when they are going for their CSR expenditure in the health policy documents. And then the most recent is the National Health Policy of 2017. And here also we see that they have written about, they have envisaged universal access to good quality healthcare, inclusive partnerships, multi-stakeholder approach, then purchase of secondaries, tertiary care services from private sector to fill the gaps in terms of access or in terms of specialists, what Padma was talking about. And of course, the National Health Policy also says that because private sector is more concentrated in urban areas, so PPP can be a mechanism for promoting health in the urban areas. And earlier, the PPPs which were there, which I had studied, were mostly in primary care. What Rama ma'am had said, that mostly into family welfare and community health. But now the shift is towards PPPs in secondary and tertiary health care. Then if we look at the effectiveness of, effectiveness as a term, it means the ability to meet the goals of a program. So and in the context of health sector, effectiveness means the contribution to meeting the goals of the health system or producing health benefits. Now, in the conceptual framework, one of the things is that I'm conceptualizing that we need to identify the features of or the characteristics of successful PPPs, and then look at how do they contribute to achieving the health system goals, like here in this figure. So these six features are there of successful PPPs. One is the relationship, like what do we define as government, what do we define as public, whether it is a ministry or a department or an agency, who is the other partner, like private partner, whether it is a international NGO, local NGO or market-based organization. Then the nature of the partnership, whether it is formalized, contractual, whether it is informal, what are the benefits that each partner seeks. Structure, so scope and functions would mean that what are the administrative mechanisms for operationalizing the partnership, whether it is hospital-based or community-based, whether it is centralized or decentralized, what are the payment mechanisms, like how it is financed, whether there is user fee or capitation or whatever. Then the financial arrangements, whether a new entity is being created with the participation of both the public and the private partners, or whether the private, whether the public sector is upgrading its own services with private funding or vice versa. Then the policy and regulatory framework, whether we have to address it through an executive means or legislative means. Again, how much of regulation is required. We have to recognize there could be potential weaknesses in the partnership in terms of missing data or in terms of inconsistencies in the data or non-availability of data. And then we look at the effectiveness, that is the outcomes. So one of the things is access in terms of availability of services, utilization and timeliness. Quality in terms of safety, efficacy, continuity of treatment. Then improved health status on various health indicators and patient satisfaction. Equity in terms of access, quality, accountability and participation of disadvantaged groups. Also the risk protection prevention from catastrophic health expenditure and fairness in financing for the disadvantaged groups. Efficiency would mean administrative efficiency, cost effectiveness, value for money and adequacy of funds. Then we have reduction in inequalities, responsiveness as defined by the WHO in terms of client orientation and respect for patients. And then we have accountability, community participation and strengthening the health system. So these are the various factors which have been identified in the literature of defining, when we say effectiveness of the health system, then all these features have to be there if we can say that we are able to meet the health system goals. So the recent evidence is whatever we have, like from the presentations by all the panelists, Madhurima and Padma. So the goal of universal healthcare or the policy pronouncement is there, but we are yet far away from it. In terms of equity in the services, there is an urban bias and there is a speciality bias. People are bearing out-of-pocket expenditures and there is social exclusion of women, of migrants and so many others. And the power asymmetries continue. The stakeholder involvement is not there. The competing or the opposing values of the public and private partners are there. And the Kelkar committee suggested that what approach we have in India as of now for PPP is more of transactional and not relational. It is based on give and take and not building on long-term relationships. So then what do we need? Do we need less role of government or redefined role of government? And if we need redefined role, then it has to be in terms of standard, defining standards for quality, safety, ensuring access, and having a regulatory framework for ensuring that the contracts are operationalized. And so to conclude, we need to bring in policy initiatives to move from transactional to relational approach and to find out ways of building trust in the partnership. Rama ma'am had also mentioned building trust, social capital and informal coordination, and that will help to reduce the power asymmetries and treat them as more as partners, because right now one is a dominant player, we can't say that they are partners. And then equity of and universal healthcare. These are the issues which have to be addressed through PPP. So how do we do that? And also whatever literature is emerging, especially in India on PPPs in health, is more of, in the morning also we were discussing this. Most of it is descriptive in nature. So I think now the field has evolved a lot and we need to go for some hypothesis testing and building conceptual frameworks and theory development. That is what my view is. And so, thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah, please. I invite Jasmine to. So now I.